from the University of Kansas Health System.
I am amazed. The team here is great.
I came on a Tuesday, and then by Saturday, I had a heart in me.
I have never seen a group of people work together so good as this team of heart specialists. I mean, it's just unreal.
Stand by to set up show.
And the Dolph C. Simons Jr. Family Broadcast Studio.
Roll it. Always makes you feel like you're the most important patient on the planet.
I felt heard, and that was really big.
This is All Things Heart.
Good morning. It is Thursday, February 24th. I'm Alexis Del Cid, and welcome to All Things Heart. This is the second week of our new live program. We are thrilled to be here. And this morning, we have a remarkable story for you. Today, you're going to learn about a rare heart transplant and a heartbreaking journey for a father and son. We're going to tell you how doctors made the tough call on who would survive. Plus, it's Heart Health Month. We're going to tell you some things you can do to keep your heart healthy that might surprise you. And you'll meet a team of artists here at the University of Kansas Health System who won a spot in a public art campaign that will also raise money to help save lives. As always, if you have a question or a comment, you can share those on our Facebook Live, our YouTube channel, wherever you're watching, or email us at allthingsheart@kumc.edu. And now to a patient who marks a first here at the University of Kansas Health System and the whole state of Kansas. This is a story with happiness and heartbreak. It's all tied up together. A father and a son, both in heart failure, only one would survive to undergo a rare transplant.
Gary Patillo says he owes everything to his cardiologist and now dear family friend, Dr. Bhanu Gupta, something Dr. Gupta's reluctant to accept.
It was teamwork.
Gary and his wife had just retired and were planning a cross-country vacation in their RV when Dr. Gupta gave him the bad news.
Dr. Gupta says, no, you're not going to do it. I'm going, why?
For Gary, it was all so strange. How did something that began with back pain and carpal tunnel syndrome turn into full-blown heart failure?
Carpal tunnel in patients above 65 raises the suspicion for amyloidosis.
Dr. Gupta's suspicions were right. Gary had ATTR amyloidosis. Underrecognized, underdiagnosed, Dr. Gupta says the most common signs of ATTR amyloidosis happened to be back pain and carpal tunnel.
It was horrible. I mean, my hands were stiffening up and aching all the time.
Amyloid protein was sticking to Gary's heart, making it stiff, thick, and unable to relax to pump enough blood. Gary's other organs were starting to fail until one day.
Doctor says, well, you're not leaving the hospital today. We're going to keep you here until we can get you a heart.
He was a candidate for a heart transplant. While Gary's family worried about him, Gary was far more worried about another heart, the one beating inside another Gary Patillo. His son, Gary Jr., on the same floor, also in heart failure.
I said, give him the heart, I'm an old man, he's a young man, give him the heart.
But Dr. Gupta delivered the shattering news to Gary Sr. His firstborn was too sick and not a candidate for a transplant. Gary was devastated, but still Dr. Gupta says Gary Jr. lit up when he got the news his dad was going to live.
And Gary was getting his heart, and he was still saying he's so happy for his dad that he's going to live.
As Gary recovered with his new heart on the same floor as his son, what followed was a surreal month. Time felt like it stood still in a dreamlike state.
But we got to, eat lunch together and watch movies and things like that, stuff that I'll always remember.
Joy and sorrow all at once, father and son existing together in a bubble.
It didn't feel real.
Gary was finally discharged and Gary Jr. stayed behind, bringing joy to his medical staff every day with his quick wit and sweet, playful nature.
He always joked around. He always had a spirit which was, I would say, indomitable spirit.
The favorite I have here is the one we were in Lake Michigan and we were fishing up there.
When Gary Jr. passed, he left behind a hole in the hearts of everyone who'd been lucky enough to have him in their sphere.
Inside that is ashes of my son, and I wear that everywhere I go. It's very, very important to me.
Gary Joining us now are Gary and his cardiologist and now his dear friend, Dr. Bhanu Gupta. Thank you both for joining us. And Gary, we're so sorry for the loss of your son, Gary Jr. He just sounds like he was a beautiful soul, and it's really beautiful that you still wear his ashes in that pendant around your neck.
Yeah, it's so important to me. I don't know, I kind of got a little emotional with all this stuff going on. But thank you very, very much for the presentation.
Thank you. Thank you for coming on here and sharing your story, your health journey, talking to us about your son. I want to ask you, where are you right now? I see the alphabet behind you in some pictures on the walls.
This is my grandson's his classroom. We homeschool him because we're so afraid of the COVID thing. So he has autism, and we homeschool him in this room.
Boy, you have your hands full. You and your wife, Connie, who's also amazing. I want to talk to you a little bit about that before we dive into the nitty-gritty of the heart condition that you had. When it comes to COVID, you're homeschooling, you have a grandson who has some special needs. How has it also changed your life as a heart transplant recipient?
It's gave me a new outlook on life. I mean, I see things differently now. It's more important that we spend time with family and not as much with friends, but we do with our family, our close ones, you know. So it's changed quite a bit as far as, because I used to be a very, very outgoing person. And I met so many people in my life and stuff like that. Now I don't see them. Me and my close-knit family.
I mean, we are living in a weird time, and even more so when you're dealing with health complications. I want to bring in someone who's become like family to you, Dr. Gupta, your doctor. Thank you for being here.
And... Hey, Gary, how are you?
I'm doing good.
Good, good. Good to see you.
Yeah, you too. You look great, man.
Oh, thank you.
As you can see, they have such an incredible bond. The bond between, I gotta be honest, the bond between Gary and Dr. Gupta, I'm kind of in love with it because you guys are kind of like bros now.
Yes.
You guys are buddies, you joke around. At the same time, you helped save Gary's life. You say he was a classic case of amyloidosis. We explained that a little bit in the story. Can you talk about how rare amyloidosis is and exactly what it is?
So amyloidosis is no longer as rare as it was thought previously about two decades ago. And over the last 20 years, we are recognizing it very often, especially men and women above the age of 65 years. In fact, anybody above the age of 65 having symptoms of heart failure, carpal tunnel syndrome, low back pain, thick heart muscles, they need to be scanned or evaluated for amyloidosis. And your question is, what exactly is amyloidosis? There are two kinds. One is AL amyloidosis, which is very different process. It's a blood disorder. But the ATTR amyloidosis, what Gary had, is a condition where the protein, or we call it sticky proteins, or they stick to the heart muscles. They are the normal protein in your body. We call it pre-albumin. They misfold and stick to your heart and nerves and soft tissues and make your heart muscles stiff, and as a result, leads to heart failure.
When we were talking to Gary, and I want to bring Gary back in here, Gary, you said that your hands were killing you, your back was killing you. I got to be honest, I never in a million years until talking to Dr. Gupta and you, what I have associated back pain and hand pain from carpal tunnel with a heart problem. Did you know that that was also associated with a heart problem?
No, I didn't. You know, I went everywhere, all the different doctors and things like that, and they were telling me all kind of different things, what was going on. And then finally what came to whole volition was I was going up the stairs one day from the basement, and my wife said, "How come you're out of breath? You know, why are you breathing so hard?" And I told her, I said, "Well, I don't think I'm breathing hard." "Yeah, you are." You know, so I went to the doctor to find out what was going on, and I'd already had the carpal tunnel surgery, and the back pain. I'd had it for a while, and then I never associated that with a heart problem, because I thought I was always healthy. And when I got to the doctor, I went to KU, and they found out that I had, you know, this amyloidosis, and I didn't know what it was. You know, I didn't even know I even had a heart problem. I thought, you know, something was going on with my back. So, You know, Dr. Gupta said, "Hey, man, you know, you need to go in and have this checked out, you know." And we'd already set up to go on a trip and everything like that, and nope, can't do it, you know. So That's when I figured out that I needed to find out what was actually going on. I didn't realize it was that bad. I really didn't. Because I never had any symptoms right. of my heart failure or anything like that, you know. It was just all of a sudden, you know, everything just hit me all at once.
Dr. Gupta, you've shared that one of the most common mutations of amyloidosis is almost exclusively found in African Americans.
That is correct.
Why is that, and how do you know if you're a carrier? Was this just a genetic mutation, or was this in Gary's family?
So there are about 3.5% African American population carry this mutation. It's called VAL121-ILE. Having a carrier, it puts you at risk for developing hereditary amyloidosis, which manifests very early, like between the age of 30 to 60, way earlier than a different type, which is wild type ATTR amyloidosis, which is what Gary had, was the wild type. So the genetic type is, we need to have low suspicion. Anybody in your family who has heart failure, if you are African American descent, if your heart muscles are thick, if you got low back pain or neuropathy, those are the signs and symptoms we need to focus on. That's why we do it very often in those scanning tests which identifies amyloidosis of the heart.
What's neuropathy? Is that the wrist pain that you're talking about?
Yeah, so there's carpal tunnel syndrome, uh-huh, where those sticky proteins stick to your carpal tunnel nerves, and also the same protein sticks to your other nerves in your legs. We call it polyneuropathy or autonomic neuropathy, where you may feel dizzy or lightheaded, your blood pressure can be very low. So those are the conditions which can alert us if somebody has amyloidosis, which is either hereditary or the wild type.
I want to ask you about Gary Jr. Gary's son, Gary Jr., he had an LVAD, and he was also really struggling. Can you talk a little bit about what was happening with Gary Jr.'s heart and what an LVAD is? I know we have some pictures that you shared with us.
Sure. So Gary Jr., unfortunately, I'm sorry for your loss, Gary. It is devastating for all of us and for you and your family. But Gary Jr. had no amyloidosis. We screened for his genetic condition. He did not have any genetic condition. So that separates Gary from any carrier. Gary was not a carrier for the amyloidosis. But he developed heart failure as a result of his diabetes and high blood pressure. He had LVAD in 2015, had a pump exchange, I think, followed by that.
And we have a picture of an LVAD.
Absolutely,
as well,
that would
to
be very.
You. So, what are we looking at here?
So, the LVAD is a heart pump which supports the left ventricle, not the right ventricle. It sucks the blood from the left ventricle chamber and circulates into your aorta and to the rest of your body. It is powered by batteries and a controller, and it is sometimes used as a destination therapy. Means people who are not eligible for heart transplant, they just continue to be supported by this wonderful device, or people can be a bridge to transplantation where this device can be help them to get to the heart transplant.
I can't even imagine, and I hope we never have to imagine what it felt like for you to have this conversation with your patient and your friend Gary, telling Gary that he was eligible for the heart, but his son wasn't eligible for the heart. Have you ever been in a situation like that before, where you had a father and son on the same floor and you had to have that conversation?
No, that's a very rare and unique situation and very unfortunate situation. And we knew Gary Jr. way before Gary. He has been with our health system couple of years before, and we knew that because of his stroke and his kidney dysfunction, he was not a candidate for heart transplant.
So he had two other things that were factors that made
correct.
It so he wasn't eligible.
That is correct.
Gary, when Dr. Gupta comes into the room and tells you we have a heart, you, like any parent, said, give it to my son. Please give it to my son.
Yes.
How do you even process that they can't and this heart is for you?
Well, you know, it's like I told the doctor earlier, you know, I've kind of lived my life. I wanted my son, he's got two young kids. I've raised all my kids. I'm going, I'd rather see my son live on than me, because I've lived my life, you know. But it wasn't to be that way. So I just had to kind of buck up and say, let's do it. You know, if he's not able to have the heart, then I guess, I might as well live on to take care of the rest of my family the way a man should.
You're doing more than just living on. You are doing such a beautiful job of sharing your son's legacy, telling us about Gary Jr. and just what a special soul he was. We have also heard from Dr. Gupta, who said that through it all, Gary Jr. was so excited to learn that you were going to live. He wanted to live on through you.
Yeah. It was hard. It was really hard for me. You know, I really wanted him to live on, because I know we around here we call him Superman. Mm-hmm. You know, and he was always the guy that enjoy the holidays, Christmas, Easter, Thanksgiving, the whole bit, you know. And, you know, Father's Day, it's not the same. Nothing's the same without this kid, you know. And, we just kind of weather the storm and do what we can. And I thank Dr. Gupta and his team and everybody involved that made this possible, that I could, you know, live on a few more years or maybe days or whatever. But I'm happy to be here. Thank you, doctor.
Absolutely, Gary, absolutely. Our pleasure. We seeing you so happy and doing so well, it's very rewarding for us, for our health system, and for people who have had heart transplant. It's amazing that they take care of a heart, which is a gift of life. Somebody has lost a life for you to live. So it is very important, and you have done an amazing job taking care of that new heart.
And I'm number 80.
I know.
So he was the first. He was the first, though, in the whole state of Kansas.
As an amyloid patient, yes.
Yeah.
You are number 80 in the list of transplants, what we have performed, but you are number one, the person in the state of Kansas.
With the amyloid, yes.
With the amyloid, yes. Wow. Amyloid diagnosis. Yes, that is correct, Gary.
Yep.
We're getting a lot of questions in from our viewers, and so we want to get to those community questions. One of the big questions that we're getting is, for Dr. Gupta, how do people know if they're watching, if they have carpal tunnel or if they have a heart condition? Because a lot of people have carpal tunnel or wrist pain.
Right, so 20% carpal tunnel is associated with cardiac amyloidosis. So 10 patients with carpal tunnel, two may have amyloidosis. So 8 out of 10 may not have it. So diagnosis of carpal tunnel does not reflect that all patients with carpal tunnel will have heart condition. So, but it is important to have it screened if you have diagnosis of carpal tunnel syndrome.
James wants to know what the rest of the staff on the same floor thought of Gary Jr. and Gary, all those nights that they were spending together playing music in their room. We've talked about that.
Yeah, I think Gary would be the better person to tell us the story.
Well, yeah, you really bonded with people on the floor.
Yeah, you know, I kind of, in my community, I started a festival down here, and it was a music festival, and we just, as my kids were growing up, we just enjoyed having music around us, and we'd play it all the time. So being at the hospital was no different of playing music, and we just injected everybody on the floor with different sounds of music, you know, rhythm and blues, jazz, rock and roll, whatever we could come up with, you know, that's what we did. So everybody there, you'd say, oh, well, we love the Patillos, you know, and it was kind of a running joke, you know. But you know, everybody up there is just absolutely wonderful. KU is the best place you want to go if you got heart problems or any other problems. That's the place to go. There's a plug for you, KU.
The University of Kansas Health System is the place to go.
Yes,
I mean,
absolutely.
We hear this all the time. I have a question from Denise, who wants to know more about your bond together. Do you hang out outside of the hospital?
Not yet.
That's a good
question. Yes, not yet. COVID, since the COVID happened, and Gary had the heart transplant during COVID time, so we are not able to do that yet. But as the relaxation and the COVID crisis or the epidemic subsides or gets controlled, we will be doing more. University of Kansas Health System has some plans to do activities. Our heart transplant patients do annual gathering where we meet every year. They wear T-shirts with their sequence of their heart transplantation. So it's always fun. It's always fun. We are looking forward to that.
We want to see pictures when that
yes,
happens.
Absolutely.
Katie would like to know, does Gary's transplant cure his amyloidosis?
No, Gary, I'm sorry, who was the question? Who asked the question?
Katie wants to know if the transplant that Gary got cured his amyloidosis.
Katie, amyloidosis was not cured. We have the treatment ongoing. We call it tafamidis, which controls and stabilizes the underlying amyloidosis process and does not or minimizes the sticky protein sticking to the new heart. And we have certain other medications which eliminates the protein or the sticky protein production. So not yet. The cure would be to get a liver transplant, which I think would be another very complex procedure.
Kristen would like to know if you think that all African Americans should be screened for this, since it is, the mutation is predominantly in African Americans.
It's about 3.5%. However, if you develop any symptoms such as neuropathy, carpal tunnel syndrome, low back pain, thick heart, or heart conditions, it needs to be screened. Not everybody in the community, because the incidence is 3.4. It is high, but unless you have some symptoms, it is better. Then it is important to have it screened.
The question from Kathy, this is for Gary. Kathy would like to know, does Gary have any plans to go on that RV trip with his wife now that he has a new heart?
You betcha. We're going. We're going. As soon as we can, we're going.
As soon as the pandemic clears?
We got a big machine in the backyard and we wanted to go. We want to go.
So ASAP, as soon as you can?
As soon as we can, yes. As soon as the weather breaks.
Well, that would be nice.
Gary has sold his lot of assets to to plan that trip, which I think before his heart transplant, we told him not to do so. Gary can tell us more about what his RV trip, what kind of investment he has made to get to that RV trip.
Yes, we sold our house. When we bought a 39-foot RV, and we were going to travel the South and Florida and the Carolinas and things like that, and you know we couldn't do it because of this. And you know, my wife, she has cancer, and I have this heart disease, and so we couldn't do anything. So everything is going okay now. And as soon as we get the releases from the doctors and everything like that, we're taking off and we're going.
I want to just back up a little bit. So throughout all this, your wife is also battling cancer?
Oh, yes. Yes.
How is she doing? Is it in remission? Do you mind us asking?
She's doing good. She's doing great. You know, we had planned this thing for years and years and years, and we decided to... that cancer, heart disease, whatever, we're going to take off and we're going to go.
Yeah.
We're going to find somewhere to go and have a good time. You know, if we can live our life out just traveling, because we're both retired, you know,
right. Why
not? You know?
I have a question that someone emailed in. It's from Gretchen. Gretchen has a question for Dr. Gupta. She writes, I'm almost 48. My maternal grandfather died from a heart attack at age 51. My maternal aunt died from a heart attack at 49. Every time I go to the doctor, they tell me my heart sounds fine and my blood work is good. Is there anything else I need to check?
Gretchen, this is an important question. There are many reasons to develop cardiac conditions. So if you're having symptoms, you need to be thoroughly investigated. That includes your risk factors for amyloidosis, if you have those risk factors or symptoms related to those.
So do you go to the doctor and your regular doctor and ask for specific tests, or do you ask to be referred to a cardiologist like you?
It's a good question. The family, your primary care doctor, it's always often thinks best for you. And I depending on your cardiac condition, it is if you've got high blood pressure, if you're developing any chest pain, shortness of breath, which is very disproportionate to your heart conditions or other conditions, it is important to see a cardiologist.
If you don't have those symptoms and they're telling you you look good, your heart sounds good, but you know that you've got two family members who died relatively young from heart attacks, is there a specific test that someone like Gretchen should ask for?
Coronary artery disease is still the number one cause for cardiac condition. So high blood pressure, coronary artery disease, and diabetes, high cholesterol. If you have those conditions, it's very important to have a reasonable, it is reasonable to ask for a referral to a cardiologist where we can order certain tests to know if you have coronary artery disease.
We have one more question coming in from Denise. Denise would like to know about stress tests. She's heard about stress tests, wants to know if she should ask for a stress test. And what is a stress test for people watching who've never had one?
There are different kinds of stress tests. One is called dobutamine stress test, where you have an echocardiogram and we exercise you or get your heart rate up with the medication dobutamine. So exercise stress test. We have a thallium or a nuclear stress test, where we give you a dye which makes your heart muscles lit up when you exercise, or we give you medications to dilate your blood vessels. So there are different kind of stress tests we can perform, and most of them have equal specificity and sensitivity or ability to diagnose heart conditions, about 85 to 90%.
I think you just answered Amanda Smith's question, but I want to double check this for Amanda. She wants to know if amyloidosis is detectable with an echocardiogram, and you just mentioned an echocardiogram.
That is correct. Echocardiogram can detect if your heart muscles, which are thick, however, thick heart muscles has different etiology or different reasons, and high blood pressure is number one. But if you have thick heart muscles, an electrocardiogram and symptoms suggestive of amyloidosis, I think we have a scan. It's called technetium pyrophosphate scan, available at University of Health System or at many other centers, which has high accuracy, exceeding more than 95% to diagnose amyloidosis. Yes.
That is accurate, 95% or
that
more.
That is correct.
This discussion has been so interesting and emotional, and I just want to thank Gary again for so bravely opening himself up to share this journey. I do want to get some final thoughts from you both, and I want to start with Gary. You call Gary Jr. your Superman, and you talked about how important it was to have a doctor like Dr. Gupta to walk beside you on your journey. What do you want to say about that, and what do you want us to know about Gary Jr.?
You know, Gary Jr. put up a great fight. We all loved him, and you know, we miss him. And a lot of the things that he went through, I didn't have to go through because, you know, I had great doctors like Dr. Gupta and the whole cardiac team. I just hope that anybody that has to go through this kind of stuff, if you're dealing with a family member and stuff like that, you just have to be strong. And the people at KU, they're real supportive. And, you know, my wife and I are just wonderful to believe that the people there at the University of Kansas is probably the most wonderful people in the world. And we thank you.
That's a pretty special thing to say. What a compliment to Dr. Gupta. And Dr. Gupta has always said, though, when I talk to you, you always shine the light back on Gary and say, Gary made this easy for you as a doctor. Why is that?
Gary, first, I would like to say that it's Gary mentioned my name multiple times, and it's not me. It's the team at the University of Kansas Health System, the surgeons, the LVAD coordinators, the transplant coordinators, our nurses, who take care of you on every moment, every second, and best care they provide. So
I just
happen to be here. So it'll be great to hear from other team members as well how they were involved in in your care and your and Gary Jr.'s care. I think Gary is a wonderful patient. He does what we tell him, and in fact, he sometimes does it so well that he becomes an example, leading example for other patients, which I really admire. When we told him that he cannot go to his RV trip, which he's invested his lifetime savings to do that, he did that. He did not go to that trip. He stayed. He followed every instructions. He'd been through a lot of tough times during his recovery, facing his son. And facing his son's sickness and impending death, which we all knew. So he's been tough, not only physically, but spiritually, and we admire him. Gary, we thank you for taking care of your new heart and your health. We appreciate that.
Thank you.
And I think we should all just think of Gary and think of Gary Jr. I've been thinking a lot about Gary Jr. and everything you've said about him and how he was your Superman, and I think that that was such a bright light for anyone who knew him. I have a final thought this morning, and this one involves hearts, but it also involves art. I want to show you something because there are 154 hearts, to be exact, that are about to be on display across the entire metro. They're part of the Parade of Hearts, and we have some teammates here at the University of Kansas Health System who created one of the winning selections. The Parade of Hearts features 154 winning designs out of 700 submissions. The winners are chosen by a special panel. Each giant heart is 5'3" tall and 5 feet wide.
Getting close.
A design submitted by a team of graphic designers here at the University of Kansas Health System is one of the winners you'll see on display this spring. It's a comic book style titled Heroes in Healthcare. We caught up with two of the artists as they painted.
It's to give thanks and show gratitude towards our frontline healthcare workers. I know they hear thank you a lot and they, you know, thanks, but I just wanted to give them like a piece that kind of visually represents that. It's just like a huge thank you.
This, we're, you know, really driving home that, you know, these healthcare providers are also people and they are doing their best to help in every way that they can.
After 3 months on display, each heart will be auctioned off to the highest bidder. Some of that money will go to the University of Kansas Health System's cardiovascular and cardiothoracic programs.
Boy, there's no better example of doctors also being real people than what we've seen today with Dr. Gupta and how he helped guide Gary through this unbelievable, unbelievable journey. The other team members who are working on the winning design that we're showing you right now include creative design manager Jeff Spiller, marketing director Amy Metcalf, and website strategy and development manager Marcia Francis. We are really proud of you all and can't wait to see your finished masterpiece on display. And we have three other winning hearts designed by some other teammates here at the University of Kansas Health System. So we're going to show you those over the next couple of weeks. Also, February is Heart Health Month, and we have a question for you. You take care of so many other people. What have you done for yourself lately? Here's nurse practitioner Shirley Verbenek with why self-care is so important.
If anything, during the pandemic, it's been less self-care and more caring for the kids that are home from school, you're working from home, so a lot more stress. And people, unfortunately, are less active. They're not going to their gym anymore. They're not able to do their normal exercise routine because of the pandemic.
Self-care looks like so many things: exercise, meditation, good sleep, getting enough rest, taking care of yourselves. So be sure to do that in every day ahead. Coming up next week on All Things Heart.
I never would have ever dreamed of missing a well child visit for my kiddos. And so that was definitely a learning lesson for me to take care of myself and not just them.
You take care of everyone else, right? So when's the last time you made an appointment for a basic checkup for you? A Kansas City woman's cancer diagnosis was just the start of her complicated medical journey. We're going to tell you about the other surprise diagnosis she got involving her heart next week on All Things Heart. So we will see you then next week. Remember to bring your questions. And again, huge thank you to Gary Patillo and Dr. Gupta for sharing your story. And Gary, we will remember your son, Gary Jr., and you telling his story helps keep his legacy alive. So thank you for sharing. See you next week.